And first of all, I would like to start by telling you a little bit what RNA editing is. So, as you all know, we have genes encoded in our DNA, and the central dogma of molecular biology tells us that these genes are transcribed upon necessity into RNA sequences, which are essentially a copy of the gene, and this RNA sequence is then downstream translated into proteins, which are responsible for most of the processes in the cell. So RNA editing is a process in which the RNA sequence is, after being transcribed from the DNA, is modified or changed, resulting in an outcome that is different than the one encoded in the DNA. So in principle, it's somewhat against the central dogma because it gives us proteins that are not encoded in the DNA. And this happens, at least in the first known cases, it happens in a very specific single nucleotide type. So there is a very long RNA sequences, few thousand base pairs long, and then some enzyme comes and changes one single nucleotide within the sequence. And there are mainly two types of editing in mammals, A2 and A2I. I would speak about A2I, and for those of you who remember, RNA editing is composed usually of four letters, A, G, C, and U, but here RNA editing changes the adenosine, the A, into a fifth nucleotide, which is the inosine. But for all practical purposes, this inosine, as far as we know at least, behaves as a G, as a guanosine. Okay. So, this is a cartoon of this process. So we have here on top the gene, the gene, and the white parts are the exons, which contain the parts that are later encoded into proteins, and the narrow parts are the introns, which are parts that are cut out of the transcript in later processing and are usually not that important, at least so people used to believe. And then the necessary condition for RNA, for A2I RNA editing is the formation of double-stranded RNA structures. So we have this RNA molecule, and there is some sequence here in the intron that matches a sequence in the intron or in the exon, and they bind together to form a secondary structure RNA, and this secondary structure is necessary because the enzyme, the other enzyme that catalyzes the A2I editing, binds double-stranded RNA structures, and when it recognizes this double-stranded RNA structure, it binds and it changes here one of the A's into a G. So this is important for the ongoing description, so please bear in mind that we need double-stranded RNA regions in order to catalyze A2I editing. So what is known about A2I editing? The first example in mammals was discovered some 20 years ago, and this is the famous glutamate receptor example. In this case, we have here a very long gene, and the other comes and changes a single nucleotide within this very long gene. This single nucleotide change results in a single amino acid change in the protein, and this single amino acid change in the protein makes the difference between being alive and being dead. So if this single nucleotide, single amino acid process does not happen properly, then the animal dies, the embryo dies in a few days, and in fact, in a normal condition, 100% of these transcripts, meaning all of these RNA molecules, are edited in the brain where they are expressed. So this is a very exact and precise procedure, and of course is essential for normal life. A few years later, a second example came about. This is a serotonin receptor, another receptor that encodes an ion channel that is expressed in the brain. Here we have five editing sites, and they happen in all combinations. So we have 32 combinations of transcripts. So any combination of these five sites can be edited. And this single transcript, therefore, can result in 32 variants, resulting in 20-something variants of proteins coming from the same transcript. So this is, again, a nice example going beyond the central dogma. And a few years later, a third example, again, interesting by itself, because the other enzyme, maybe you remember this is the enzyme that catalyzed the editing, it turns out that it edits itself in some negative feedback loop that I cannot explain now. But the big picture is that within the 90s, three examples were discovered. And is it important? Is it relevant? So I already mentioned that when we knock out the other enzymes, thus prohibiting the effect of editing, the animal dies embryonically. This is true for other one and for other two separately. And aberrant editing is related with many different diseases, epilepsy, glioblastoma, inflammation, obesity, etc., etc. And besides impressing you with a wide scope of diseases, I want to stress, note that many of these are in some way related to the brain or to the central nervous system. So this will come up again later. Okay, so what is there to do for a computational study? So since in 10 years, only 3 examples were discovered, so this is clear that this was not done in any systematic way. And in fact, the way that people discovered these 3 examples were just by chance. A single lab studied a single gene for many, many years from all angles and aspects, and then someone noticed that there is some systematic change in the RNA. In the first time they said it's an error, third time it's an error, fifth time it's an error, and sometime eventually they realized this is something interesting. So there were only chance discoveries. However, there are some hints suggesting that the scope of this phenomena is actually much larger, and these are, first of all, some biochemical experiments isolated inosine from the total RNA in the brain and found very large amount of inosine ranging up to 1 per 17,000 base pairs in rat's brain. So without doing the math, it's clear that this number is far, far too big than being explained by 3 nucleotides in 3 genes. Also, the phenotype of other one knockout, the fact that the animal dies when we knock out other one, is not explained, not accounted for by the 3 known targets. So we knew, or people knew, that there are more editing sites and important editing sites that we didn't discover yet. So this was the motivation to look for more editing sites. So how can one do such a search? So one group in 2003 suggested to look for ultra-conserved regions, and it turns out that these regions in the DNA that are edited are typically conserved between species even more than the regular protein encoding regions. So they focused on ultra-conserved regions. They did a very big search, and this yielded one additional target. So now the number of targets, of known targets, increased from 3 to 4. No, between human and different species. Human, mouse, rat, etc. Okay. Another biochemical method that tried to directly fish out from the total RNA transcripts that are enriched with inosine succeeded in finding 19 more targets, and these targets did include inosine, but not inosine that changes the sequence coding for protein, but rather the inosine was in the non-coding parts of the transcript. So each transcript has the coding part in which every 3 codons encode a protein, amino acid, and then there are parts in the beginning and in the end that do not code proteins. So all these 19 inosines were in parts that do not code protein. Okay, so then we came, and we had the following idea. So first of all, let me explain to you what is GenBank. So for those who don't know, this is the database that used to include all the sequencing data in the world. So everyone sequencing a piece of DNA or a piece of RNA deposited it in this database. And at the time, we had, besides the genome sequence, which was completed, this is 2004 we're talking about, so the genome, human genome was already completed, and in addition, we had there millions of sequences, of short sequences, coming from RNA, let's say, from human, different tissues, different conditions, and each short sequence was about 5,000 base pairs long, and it corresponded to an RNA molecule from some tissue, some condition. And the point is that these sequences included many, many sequencing errors or mistakes, meaning that when you match the sequence into the genome, you find mismatches, and most of these are just sequencing errors or mistakes that comes from the process, the measurement process, if you want. However, some of them could come from the fact that RNA editing changes adenosines, genomic adenosines into inosines. The sequencer's machines read inosines as guanosines, and therefore one would see a mismatch between a genomic adenosine and an RNA guanosine that should signal to us RNA editing. Okay, so we took what was available back then, 200,000 RNA sequences and 6 million ESTs. ESTs is expressed sequence tags. It's small parts, small sequences, about 500 base pairs long on average of cDNA, of DNA coming from RNA, basically. And therefore, and we took these sequences and tried to look for mismatches. Okay, so how do we do with that? So first thing is to learn from examples. So this is the first known example of RNA editing that I mentioned before, the glutamate receptor. And here you see in this plot, the second line here is the genomic sequence, and all the lines below are different RNA sequences from GenBank. And you can see that here in this location, the genome says A, but some, or actually most, of the RNA sequences here say G. So we see that there is a mismatch between A to G as we wanted. So this is... it depends from where this comes from. It could come from RNA that was not edited yet, or it can come not from the brain. Okay, so this is a classical... The problem is that there are many, many such sites, of course, and this is what it looks like, and the main, or at least in the beginning we thought that the main source of noise for us, or the thing that could be problematic for us, is that this structure, meaning having part of the sequences giving one nucleotide and the other giving another nucleotide, is exactly what you see when you look at a site which is polymorphic. Polymorphic means that different individuals, different people, have different nucleotides in the same place. So there are millions and millions of such sites in the human genome. Currently, we believe that about 1% of the nucleotides in the genome are polymorphic. So this site could be very well a polymorphic site. So this brings us again to the classic problem of the needle and the haystack. We have tens of millions of polymorphic sites, and we have an unknown number of editing sites. So the known number was 4. So we don't know how many there are, but probably less than 30 million. So we have much less points that we want to find. So how can we find this needle from the haystack? And the solution, as usual, is that we have some... You need to find some distinctive feature of this needle, for example, its size, yes, that helps you to push it, to pull it from the haystack. So in this case, the distinctive feature was the fact that RNA editing sites, if they are important, if they are relevant for function, they should appear in not only in human, but also in cross species, in other mammals, for example. So polymorphic sites, by definition, are sites that are different between me and you. So there is no reason to believe that it will be the same when we compare two different mice, for example, right? Because if they are so much not that important that they differ between different people, different humans, then clearly they shouldn't be conserved to other species. However, editing sites, at least if they are important, should be conserved. And therefore, when we look for mismatches for polymorphic or sites that look like polymorphic, but we find the polymorphic in the same way, in the same position exactly, this is a signature of being not a polymorphic site, but actually an RNA site. So this was the first strategy, actually the second strategy we used. And indeed, this led to 4 additional editing sites that we found, in addition to the 3 or 4 that were known before, actually 3. And in addition to this, we found another 4. And this method later, by different groups, added a few more, 2 or 3 more. Yes?
Don't you also need them to click on themselves, or don't they need also
to create a secondary structure?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, so we know that they should create a secondary structure. The problem is, I will use this feature later, but for this search, we found that it doesn't help. And the reason is that our understanding of secondary structure of RNA is not good enough to use it as filter.
So, the locations in the RNA?
It's essentially the same thing, right? You need the intron to be to create a secondary structure. And the problem is that our prediction of secondary structure is too noisy to use for this search. Actually, some people, we tried it, other people tried it, and it doesn't help. Okay, so this is an example. This is the genome A. Here are some sequences that we pulled from GenBank. We find two Gs and four A's, so we said this is a candidate. We found exactly the same picture in mouse, so we said this is an editing site, and this is the experiment, and this is a result of sequence experiment. The green here, I believe, is A, and the black is G. So you see in this spot, when we sequence the DNA of some donor, we find only adenosine, so the DNA is clean, there is no polymorphism here, but the RNA has a small A peak and a large G peak, so there is editing of about, 60-70% of the transcripts of this individual are edited. Okay. So this was 2005, and last year, actually 2009, a year and a half ago, a new approach came about, which is actually not a new approach. It's the same approach, but using new technology. So as you know, the next generation sequencing is now available. And a single experiment nowadays that costs about $5,000 produces the same amount of data that was present in GenBank when we used it. These 6 million sequences are now produced in a single experiment in $5,000 probably. So this method that I don't have time to explain in detail used this next generation sequencing and some novel capturing idea, and they discovered 40 additional recording sites. So the number of recording, editing recording sites now increases from the 3 that were known about a decade ago to 50, more or less. Okay, so this is the first part. However, this is not enough. As I mentioned before, we have 1 per 17,000 inosines in the RNA. This is way too big number to be explained by 40 or 50 or 100 editing sites. And so we knew that there should be more, and we knew from this experiment that I mentioned before that there should be, or probably most of them are, in non-coding parts of the RNA. So how do we find them? Again, in principle, it's easy. Look for mismatches. However, there are many, many different types of noise that we have to avoid. And we cannot use now these distinctive features that I talked about. Conservation does not help you when you look for non-coding regions. They are not conserved. Because they are not coding, they are not so well conserved between species. So we need another feature, and here we use the secondary structure that Roy mentioned before. So let me skip this. The point is, let's look for secondary structure, double-stranded RNA. And what we did, in short, was to go over the whole human genome and look for all the regions that are potentially double-stranded RNAs. So this is a technical point. And when you do this, this is not such a small group. We found that in about 60 or 70% of human genes, there are regions that are potentially double-stranded RNAs. This is quite common. And there are about 429,000 such regions. And then we focus on these regions. The typical range is 300 base pairs. So we have quite a large fraction of the genome, but yet, when we focus on it, so this is the cartoon of what we did, we take these regions that are potentially double-stranded RNAs, we did all kinds of filtering, cleaning the RNAs, we removed the known polymorphic sites, and then we collected the remaining mismatches, the remaining disagreements between RNA sequences and DNA sequences. And lo and behold, when we do all this filtering and we focus only on double-stranded RNA sites, we get the distribution of mismatches to look like this. So all the mismatches that we found were only of this type A to G. Almost all, yes. So for example, here you see distribution of mismatches coming from different sources. This is just random parts of the genome. You see a not uniform, but more or less uniform distribution of mismatches, the distribution of polymorphism sites. This is for mutations. But when we do all this filtering, you can clean up everything, and we are left only with A to G editing sites. And this is a very strong signal that these are really editing sites and not something else. So this We have numbers here, so depending on the parameters and the desired signal-to-noise ratio, we can say that there are about either 12 or 13,000 very sites that we are very confident about, or 50,000 sites with a high signal-to-noise ratio, low signal-to-noise ratio, and these were validated. I mean, some of them were validated also experimentally, and we know that the list is more or less accurate. And so here, practically, what we did is we used the number of G to A mismatches, cases where we have G in the genome and A in the RNA sequence, and this is not editing, and this was used to us as to calibrate the noise. But then in the experiment, we just took a few, maybe 25, I don't remember exactly, 25 targets and sequenced them, and they found more than 90% success. So. Okay, so many things can be done here, and I don't have time, so let me focus on one point before I end. So 95% of these sites are located in ALU. ALU is a repetitive sequence that is present in our genome, and there is about 1 million copies of this sequence. It's about 300 base pairs long, 1 million copies. So 10% of our genome is just the same sequence repeated itself 1 million times with minor changes. So 95% of the editing sites reside in this junk DNA. Another thing to know about the ALU sequence is that it's primate specific. It does not appear in mouse. In mice, for example, only in human and chimpanzee and rhesus, etc., only in monkeys and humans. So obviously, we ask ourselves, is there anything special about the ALU sequences that makes it so editable? So we have 15 or 50,000 editing sites. What happens in other species? So we did the same thing for mouse. So to remind you, this protocol that I described gives you 13,000 sites in human. When you do the same thing in mouse, you end up with 300 sites. So it's about 40-fold difference between human and mouse. And for people coming from biology, they know that mouse and human are about the same, except for the tail. So if you find something that is 40-fold different between human and mouse, this is a big story. Okay, so something is different. I must say, to be honest, that there is a very big difference in a very non-important part of the DNA. So this is junk DNA, so who cares? But still, we find something that a biological process that differs 40-fold between human and mouse, and happens, I remind you, in most of human genes, about half of human genes. Okay, so this is the first thing, and I'm almost done. Recently, we went further and asked what happens when we compare human to different primates. So now they have the ALU sequence, and in principle it should be exactly the same with respect to editing levels. So we took a few individuals, four humans and two chimpanzees and two rhesus monkeys, and selected some genes. And without going into the details, just look at this figure. Blue is high, yellow is low, and we compared the editing levels in about 100 editing sites between the individuals. And you see that humans have way higher editing level compared to primates, about twofold higher on average. And this is when all of these species have the same ALU in the same position. The genome is almost the same, 99% the same in these regions. Everything is the same, and yet we find a twofold difference. We don't know how to explain this. We do know how to explain the 40-fold difference between human and mouse in terms of the genomic properties of these species, and we did the same for other mammals and flies and fish, etc., etc. This we know to explain. But this result, we have no explanation for this difference, but we just found it. And let me just end with some fantasy, maybe. So here is the evidence for connecting maybe A2I editing to brain complexity. So first, A2I editing is most prevalent in the brain. This is true in mammals, certainly true in humans. So A2I editing is connected to the brain tissue. The aberrant editing and editing knockouts is strongly connected to neurological disorders, as we saw before. And A2I editing is known, I didn't describe it, but is known to relate to RNAi and microRNAs. These are all kinds of processes that control the RNAs in different ways and add to the complexity of the transcription to translation step. So again, in contrast to the central dogma in which RNA is just a messenger, it's called an mRNA, just a messenger going from the genome to the proteome, we now know that there are many, many complex regulatory processes happening in the RNA level, and all of, at least many of them are known to connect to A2A editing. And as we mentioned, it's 40 times higher in human compared to mammals, it's twofold higher compared to monkeys. And finally, another thing that I didn't mention is, when we look for, I said that RNA elements are present in human and in primates, but when we look for these few RNA elements that are unique to us, that are present only in humans and not in chimpanzee, there are about 5,000 of these, among the 1 million copies, 5,000 are unique to human, and then we ask, in which genes do these 5,000 appear? Is it just a random sample of the genes or not? So it's not a random sample. These genes are very strongly associated with CNS, the central nervous system, again, brain-related genes. And finally, the concluding evidence is that it says in Tanakh, "Umotar Adam mina bema ay." So certainly, there is a reason to believe that this A to I editing has something to do with brain complexity, and we are going to check this in the future years, hopefully. So to sum up, we developed new methods, several new methods for detecting A2I editing sites. We found a handful of new sites that recode new proteins, and this list was largely enlarged in recent year by a new deep sequencing technology. When we look for non-coding RNAs, there are thousands or tens of thousands, and people today talk about hundreds of thousands of editing sites in non-coding RNA in humans. And in general, we should know that next-generation sequencing allows us, with a reasonable cost, to produce a huge amount of sequencing data. Therefore, it presents new opportunities and promises to really help us develop this direction. We know that RNA editing impacts several mechanisms that relate to the double-stranded RNA structure, including RNAi, et cetera, microRNAs. It is primate or maybe even human-specific in a way, and the question is still open whether it contributes to the brain complexity, and I hope to be able to know more about it in the near future. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay. The talk is open for questions. Yes, please.
Eddie, that's very nice. So one thing that, if I understood right, if you look at different parts of different tissues, you expect to see no RNA editing, right?
No, so different levels of RNA editing. So brain is the highest, there are also other tissues that are high, but in other...
Okay, can you use that? So if you have sequences from the same person, right, to look at different from the same person, different tissues, you can see different frequencies of A to G and maybe use that to identify.
Exactly. When we have a single person, the problem is not as severe, because the main problem, or at least one of the biggest problems, is distinguishing between A to I editing and polymorphisms. So now, if you have a single person, then either it's a it has the same two alleles, or it's heterozygous. But then it's 50-50. But it's very easy to distinguish between 50-50 or 100% zero and editing site, which is anywhere between 0 and 100. This is not the main problem. The problem is when you have a pool of people. And then it's very difficult to distinguish between SNPs and polymorphisms and editing sites. And then we often use what you just suggested. If we see changing levels between different tissues, this cannot be genomic polymorphism, but rather an endogenous process that happens in RNA level. So this is something we use.
The fact that ALU repeats and RNA editing appeared around the same time, and the fact that the editing destabilizes or breaks the hybridization, that is possibly, does it suggest that the editing is a mechanism for the cells to fight this parasitic element that appeared?
Yes. So RNA editing did not appear when ALU appeared. RNA editing is present in almost all metazoa, including C. elegans. But it is true that one of the theories is that RNA editing in human is high because it fights the IU desire to multiply. So that's true. So either there are different variants of this story, but in the broad picture is yes, that RNA editing is also a defense mechanism against RNA viruses.
Time for one more question? If not, yes.
Maybe it's a contradicting question to the previous one, but it makes sense to me. Editing is part of a feedback loop, but what is the biological rationale of 100% editing? Is it the previous answer?
No. Well, that's a very good question, and people have been asking me this for quite a long time. We have site that is both 100% edited and which its editing is necessary for life. So why isn't it mutated to the correct nucleotide? There's no good answer yet. So some people believe that maybe in some exotic condition, maybe in some distant tissue.
Yes.
So people do that. When you take other two knockouts. The mouse dies embryonically. If, in addition to knocking out other two, you also correct this glutamate receptor editing sites, the mouse lives. So you can happily, I didn't interview it. It seems that yes. So it lives, and it's not easy to find what is wrong with it.
Yes. It's not that right. I mean, firstly, it does change the stability of the RNA.
Right, so it does many, many things, but the point is that when you change a single editing site, you rescue the knockout. So the effects are less dramatic than lethality, but I find it encouraging because dramatic effects are not very easily used for evolutionary development. You need to make small steps. So
I think we need to move on, so let's thank the speaker once again, but before you get up,